know your user to build the right thing, and then of course build the thing right. And why is it so important to know your user? Because sometimes, you know, it's very easy to follow the trend, emulate competition, double down on what investors want or what, you know, your tech team wants to build. But in the short term and the long term, there has to be no confusion. Customer obsession will help you win. And what this means in the world of product is to know who you're building for and why it matters to them, and to work backwards from the problem into the solution, not start with a solution and say, I'm in search of a problem. So don't optimize for being the coolest tech or the fastest tech. But first, most importantly, right? Why do we talk to users? These conversations take time. They are easy to mess up. And without them, you know, you can go down the wrong path, build a product or an experience or a service that's not working, not landing, not growing on multiple fronts. And not knowing your users can actually have serious downstream impact. And that's because the product that you build may not solve a problem deep enough, and then will also impact how you grow and communicate. And which means, how do you do your messaging? How do you do the positioning? How do you go and find channels where you can reach to your users? And this is actually the foundation of BMF, right? Like, just knowing who are your users, what is the problem? Are you solving it deep enough? And this is a reason we emphasize on this so much, is that you cannot wing it. Because we often find that teams are not able to align on what matters most. So founders, early stage teams, even later stage orgs have all run into these problems. And the bottom line is that you can very easily build something, but to increase your chance of creating something that is solving a real problem, you just need to be more rigorous in your approach. I would argue that it begins with knowing your users and your customers. So first things first, you are not your only user. Most of us begin building products because we resonate with the problem deeply, or we've experienced it firsthand, or we've seen users experience a problem intimately when working on something similar, which is how most SaaS products come about. Or if you've seen someone close to us experience this, right? But when we begin to zoom out from ourselves, and the first step is just talk to customers, navigate the noise, and learn what they really want. And every stage of your product will be deeply rooted in knowing your users. You may be here at this point where you're just trying to find early adopters, someone who understands your vision. You may begin with someone who's like you, right? Or your circles of trust, which is your friends, your family, your colleagues, your first 10 users. And you will slowly start expanding beyond these into other groups. And early adopters are not who are going to get you to scale. And this is a constant work in progress. Every time you cross that step, you will have to go back and do that hard work of getting to the heart of who are these new users, what are their problems, and how can your product solve it for them. And this is also very, very critical, that when you are starting out, especially in the 0 to 1 or the 1 to 10 journey, it's very hard to build a product that, you know, several types of users love, especially when you're starting out. So one of the things that we focus on is just go deep and solve the problem for one particular user type, right? And just one particular user. And this is why we say personas describe the center of a market segment. You can figure out then who is it that you are going after and how can you go deeply and solve it for them. So why do this, right? First, it's just because if your mission vision is aligned, then everybody on your team and in your company will know why you're building this. So it helps you align on where you should be going, and knowing your user will help you double click on, you know, executing on that mission in a cohesive manner. Second, it just creates consistency. Everybody just knows whose problem you're solving and why you're solving this problem. And then the other piece is, if there is an argument where you've got somebody saying, oh, I think we should build this or we should build that, just talk about the user who you're solving it for. And that's it. That would help you focus and bring just more empathy. And finally, of course, right, just a framework for your design, for your go-to-market, because now you know where to go and how to just, where do you go reach for your users? The most important, as you think about understanding the user and their context, is knowing their truths and their problems. So who is this person? What are the problems they want to solve? And why do they want to solve these? And you've got to try and build as exhaustive a picture of your customer as you can. So if you've got demographic and psychographic data, make sure you include that. What you're trying to do here is you're trying to understand a real person, right? For whom you're solving a significant pain point, which is basically go deep, understand the details. And you will have to start with intuition, but this is where interviews and surveys and other forms of data come in, because you'll have to sharpen that intuition with data. And the most important thing here is that your personas will tell your team what your users are thinking, feeling, and what they would like to accomplish, right? So who is the user? What is, you know, what do they care about? And what is the problem that they are trying to solve that your product can help with? What are their pain points, their frustrations, their needs? What do they face currently? What, you know, what are their needs that are unsolved? What frustrates them? What are their insecurities? And what motivates them to solve these problems? And you'll have to keep going into detail. Some of these are things that you may not be able to observe, but you'll have to infer through questions. And of course, the most important, which is what does success and transformation for a user look like when their problem is solved? Here we've got three user personas, CHRO Kathy, IT head Ivan, and business owner Blake. This is for HR software for remote teams. So you can see that CHRO sees the potential in remote work, but there are issues around compliance and cost that stress her out. IT head Ivan is starved for talent and wants to explore talent that he can onboard quickly. Now the business owner or the CEO Blake, on the other hand, is worried about remote work. And if you see the last line, it has a very clear description of what success and outcomes look like for each of these personas. One wants to have compliance made easy. Another wants to find great talent to solve his backlog. And the CEO just wants to hire quickly so that the business can scale. So you can see that for Kathy, we know what her goals are. What is the success she's looking for? What are the designations that she can go by in other companies? And especially if you're a SaaS product, then you will find this extremely relevant, because in some places it might be CHRO, in another place it might be VP of HR or HR director. So this will help you narrow down who you target. Can we have multiple personas? You may end up targeting three user personas, right? Because you might end up having with a buyer, a user, and then an influencer. In this case, CHRO Kathy would end up as a buyer. IT head Ivan ends up as a user, and then Blake would end up as most likely the influencer. There are times you will see that your buyer and your user personas will overlap, especially when you are doing bottoms-up adoption or you're doing product-led growth, or you find yourself targeting prosumers. So here, for example, you have Atlassian, which targets developers, right? And that's how it spreads through the organization. Figma targets designers who can both end up buying and using, and then of course Product Board, which targets product managers, so ending up with both buyer and user. So the buyer is usually the decision maker who's looking at the product to achieve some goals. They write the check for the product to get the job done, right? But the user is the one who ultimately ends up using the product. And like I said previously, may or may not be the same as the buyer, but they're ultimately responsible for engagement and even retention. An influencer, and this is someone you should just keep track of, is, you know, it's usually the buyer, not the buyer, but can tilt the decision. And this, you know, if you're looking at, for example, a product like Figma, your buyer might just be the VP of design or VP of engineering. Your user is your designer. And the influencer may be the VP of IT, who decides that, hey, you know what? We can't actually have the software deployed in our system. These are recommended questions so that you can dive deeper and ask the right question to get to the heart of what is it that you need to know. So knowing the details about the business, their job title and reporting will help you create your landing page forms, right? And will help you create your conversion messages. The factors like industry and company size will help you understand how many hats this person might be wearing on a daily business, on a daily basis, or how competitive their market is. A focus on your buyer's career and seniority level will help you determine what makes them successful, what are they worried about. And the idea to catch all of these details is for you to create solutions, whether it is a product, a service, or an experience that are catered specifically to them. And, you know, of course, understanding what they buy, what tools they use will help you also figure out your positioning, your marketing, your messaging, and, you know, just selecting which benefits to highlight based on where they're coming from. Dig out the user's why. Just please focus on understanding the frustration. Ask specific why questions. The five whys is a great way to dig out motivations. And then just build empathy, right? And just track the initial reasons to solve a problem and track it as far back as possible. When did this happen? Why did this happen? What did you do in this situation? focus on real events and feelings, not abstract or presumed ones. And of course, connect the dots, right? Just start at the frustrating situation and figure out how you can go to successful transformation. I've got some questions in red and some questions in green because, you know, these are good questions to ask, or, you know, just make sure you skip these questions. The main takeaway on this one, folks, is do not ask people about the future. We're all irrational beings and we're either extremely optimistic or pessimistic. You know, think about it, right? Like if we said, how often would you work out next week? We say 5 times a week. How many times did you work out last week? Well, zero, right? So don't ask people about the future and ask them only about the past. Because if you make someone choose between being honest and being perceived as good, they will always choose the latter. So do not put them in that situation. So ask them questions like, in the past, how often did you do this? Last time your team did something, how many people needed to get involved? So you want to capture quantitative data about what happened in the past. And you also want to allow people to tell you things like the fact that it takes them half a day to send out an email campaign, right? So instead of asking them how long something took, which could be read as judgment, just ask them a very specific question. Did it take longer than 4 hours? Did it take longer than 6 hours? You don't want the person to feel bad, right? Or like they might be doing a bad job when you point out the shortcomings of their existing solutions. That's when they'll shut down and you will not be able to learn. The other question that I think you should ask is, who else should I talk to? Because what this will do is then allow you to figure out if there is somebody, if there are more people that you can target who are similar to this person you're speaking to in terms of at least the commonality of the problem. Some things to keep in mind as you talk to users: don't tell the user what their problem is. They are the expert. Listen. Don't ask steering, leading, pitching questions, right? Watch for compliments, especially when they're trying to make you feel good about your idea, because they know it's your product, it's your company. So then they will often, you know, users will try and steer the conversation away to make it more complimentary, and you'll have to deflect it and bring it back to what is actually very useful, which is knowing how they're using a particular product, knowing what their problems are, know what fluff looks like, especially if someone says, I always ask them to double click and say, how often, when did you do this, what happened? And most importantly, do not pitch your idea or solution, because you are the expert on the solution. At this point in time, when you are doing these user interviews, especially if you're trying to figure out what is the product that you need to build for them, you want to just listen to what, you know, the user has to say about the problem and not about your solution. Unless, of course, they're users of your product, in which case you might want to ask them very specific questions about how are they using the product, what are they doing, when did they fail, what did they do differently? What would they, you know, what do you wish they would have done? And things like that. And finally, just this is how you have to continually stay in touch with your users. The goal is to create like a robust, holistic view, right? And remember this, like people are not static. People change, their behaviors change, their roles, responsibilities, needs, pain points change. So just make sure you're continually in touch, because your ideal user is a living, breathing definition that you will come back to and also modify very often. Because what will happen is, and as you can see on the slide, you have two kinds of data that you will end up collecting. One is your qualitative, which is how does, you know, you live a day in the life by replicating their life or workflow. You set up WhatsApp chats, Facebook groups, and talk to them quite often, or you shadow users as they go about their day. And the other one is to just look at the data and use that to inform your user personas a lot more, which is you look at their engagement metrics, you look at feedback and customer support tickets. And this is something that I really like, to at least understand user personas and what users respond to, how do they, you know, how do they respond to certain communication, is to run fake door or the sort of Oz experiments. Fake door is just basically where you pretend to have a product and, you know, just run it via a Facebook ad, et cetera, to see if the communication lands and to see if they act on it. So what is the problem you are solving? Having clarity on these problems is super important, because it is the single biggest driver of alignment, and it helps you all row in the same direction, and it helps just helps you land your product and your company. As you think about building products, do remember that the hero in this journey is your user or the customer, and it's not the product.